Our final speaker for the day is Bishop Matthew Hassan Kuka. Bishop Kuka is the current bishop of the Roman Catholic Diocese of Sokoto, ordained a Catholic priest in 1976. Bishop Kuka has vast years of working experience within the church, the academia, and is a respected statesman. His academic pursuits culminated in 1990 with a doctorate degree from University of London School of Oriental and African Studies. He is also a senior Rhodes Fellow at Oxford University. As a statesman, he has served as a member of the Human Rights Violations Investigation Commission in Nigeria. He is the present chairman of the Ogonishell Reconciliation Committee and the pro-chancellor and chairman of the Governing Council, Nasarawa State University, KEFI. He's speaking today on the platform on Nigeria's gangrene, amputation or surgery, thoughts on healing a traumatized nation. You're welcome, sir.
Ever since generations, they've been saying it will change, that it will change, it will change, it will change, but we never see the change. Stand up and fight back, you got nothing to lose. I think that is a fitting Jimmy Cliff tribute to the speaker who has just spoken. And it leaves me with, I don't want to say nothing to say, but I really want to thank on your behalf, because I think that this is really what accountability is all about. And I think it also speaks to the larger issues of the terrible mistake that Nigerians make in thinking that what we want are holy, God-fearing people to govern this country. Unfortunately, I often say the Chinese, I don't know how many churches are in China and how many mosques are in China. So I think the issues are character and vision. And it's also not enough to want to do good. I think what is important is to understand even the conceptual architecture of governance. That is, how do you, all this stuff we keep talking about, cutting down waste and so on and so forth, all of us are beneficiaries of waste. And unless you have somebody with the internal capacity to understand, and I think this is what we've just listened to, but I'm not here to comment so much on my previous speaker. But Governor Obi, I want to thank you. And I hope that the platform can actually invite presidents, governors who want to take the risk. Who want to take the risk of coming here to give an account of their stewardship. As opposed to most of the manufactured consent that we get here and there. But anyway, I chose to speak on what I call Nigeria's gangrene. I don't know how the idea came to me, and I had to call a doctor friend of mine to ask, look, what, first of all, I have an idea about what gangrene is. But I was interested, and I thought it fitted the conversation about Nigeria, because there is something insidiously wrong that every day we gather, we are lamenting about the same things. You know, when Fela sang about 99 people standing, we weren't that many. Now we are 170, so there are more than 99 people standing. And still, we are still suffering and smiling. But my concern, this morning, I decided to do what I normally don't do. But I went to YouTube, and I Googled the speech, I mean, not the speech, the interview I had with Channels. I think it was on the 13th of September last year, which provided some of the arrows, the bullets, the guns that were used against me, and I was called all kinds of names, including the fact that Jonathan had given me money to and done so well for me, which is why I was defending him. But when I went through and listened to myself, I felt mightily proud. Yes, I felt mightily proud, because there is not a single sentence that I would have wanted to take away. And if you have the courage, go back and play the tape again and listen to the things I said. Because they were not born out of any feeling of mischief. They were born out of my personal little but limited understanding, but also convictions about how nations run and about how transitions take place and about how we might be able to construct an architecture that focuses more on the future than the past. Over a year later, I don't want to beat my chest and say I feel vindicated. But of course, I feel quite happy that everything I said, literally, I felt a sense of vindication. Now, gangrene, in summary form, based on what my doctor told me, you know, when you suffer from gangrene, Dr. B is here, and I didn't think of the fact that he'll be here, but it could be caused by anything, diabetes, smoking, accident, whatever. But you lose sensation because oxygen doesn't flow, the blood doesn't flow to where it's supposed to be. And I use this metaphor because I think that something has gone very wrong with Nigeria and how the blood is flowing, what is stopping the blood flow. Because, and of course, the evidence is there, and I will share some of the evidence to you. But I pose the question that if we are underperforming, and if we are feeling so sad, we are not sad, we are not happier now than we were last year. Okay, because this is a country where the future is always in reverse, and we drive only in reverse gear. Because yesterday was better than, because I was struck last year, there was something going on WhatsApp saying, you know, please bring back corruption. Because they said, at least under corruption, we knew how much we paid for fuel. Under corruption, we knew how much we paid. It was bizarre, but it was a reality. Now, when you suffer from gangrene, you lose sensation on the vital part that is infected. I remember the story of a man was celebrating his silver jubilee with his wife. He decided that they would go out for dinner. And then as they were driving to the restaurant, the man says to his wife, you know, honey, I read something that, you know, if you are suffering from leprosy, you lose sensation. And the wife said, what kind of nonsense is that? We are going for dinner. Well, how does leprosy come into? He said, no, I just read it. The wife said, okay, thank you, but please, let's go. So they get to the restaurant, and it's a candlelit restaurant because they were being expected. So they sit down, they're having dinner. And then midway, the man turns to his wife, he says, you know what? I think I've come down with leprosy. The wife says, what is all this? He says, you know, my leg was itching, and I've scratched it twice, and I don't feel sensation. The wife looks at him and said, you're very stupid. It's my leg you've been scratching. You know? So, but the question I think we need to pose is, if as it is, we find ourselves having lost the vital white cells that should help to fight the disease that Nigeria faces, do we need amputation, which is one way of healing, curing gangrene, because you need to save the rest of the body, or should it be surgery? Now, we become hostages to language, and we often in Nigeria think in vernacular and try to speak in English. You know, because, you know, whenever Nigerians talk, you hear them say something like, you know, but in my language, you know, they can use a proverb to explain. But there's always something about the English language that limits your capacity for expression. Now, those of you who went to primary school, if you went at the time that some of us went to school, in this class, the teacher wrote very boldly, and it was not to be cleaned by any child, speak English only. And every child, and the teacher gave a warning that if you had anybody speaking vernacular, you deal with, you report to the teacher, and you got a few lashes. And one day the teacher enters the class, and this young man comes, he says, "Sir, I want to report Ade." So what did Ade do? He spoke vernacular, sir. And the teacher said, "Oh, okay, Ade, what happened?" He said, "Look, since I entered this class, sir, I've not said a word. I've not spoken to anybody." The teacher turns to the young man who is reporting Ade, says, "Well, Ade says he's not said anything." He said, "No, sir, he didn't speak, but he laughed in vernacular." And then the teacher says, well, the teacher found it very curious. He said, "Okay,